Welcome to People. I'm Shirley Lin. Today I'm really honored that my guest is Joanna Lei, who is managing partner of Azul Management. Am I saying it right?
Absolutely right, Shirley. Thank you.
Well, she was also the former vice president of American Broadcasting Company, ABC TV. And when she came back to Taiwan, she has been in politics, a legislator. She spent 16 and a half years in the U.S. and 7 years in Singapore. But the last 3 years was in between Singapore and Taiwan. Well, welcome, Joanna. Can I call you Joanna?
Absolutely. And okay. That was a great thumbnail sketch about my life.
Okay. Well, first of all, I believe that when you were in the States, you started off at ABC as a research editor.
Correct.
But then only in a short 7 years, you became the vice president. How did you do it?
By working like a crazy person.
I'm sure.
But also, when I went into ABC, strictly from the academia background, I was at the University of Pennsylvania, I was hired out of school. When I first went into ABC, it was a time of turmoil. Traditional broadcast television was challenged by cable left and right. All of a sudden, everything we put on the air needs to be closer to the audience, and we needed to adopt new disciplines such as market research and mm-hmm. better understand what the audience wants and needs. And a researcher like me had an unusual opportunity because I was able to help people help the decision makers at the company find out how to make new approaches and new access to the public base. And we invented a lot of new methods which were very interesting at that time and still very interesting at this time by adopting knowledge-based decision making into a traditional, very gut-feeling kind of decision making process. I stood out from other executives and got one after another opportunities to make a difference.
Did you take this personality after your father, maybe?
Probably.
You know, aggressive and take initiative.
You know, that's an interesting observation. In the traditional culture here, people see me as pretty aggressive and oftentimes taking leadership position. But in the United States, they saw me as a really good girl in the sense that when we have a need, for example, the company really needed to find out what the young people would like to watch in terms of network news, I would be the one who say, let me do it. And I take the responsibility. I went out and got the responses, brought it back, reported it back to the decision-making process without really challenging whose judgment is right or wrong. Mm-hmm. Let me put a contrast here. Traditionally, in the network business, people are proud to have a golden gut. Like, I know what Americans want. My decisions are better than yours because my gut is better than your gut feeling. When I went in through a knowledge approach that's less threatening, non-aggressive to that sense. So every time when I started talking about a new direction, it was always based on a very clear understanding, almost like having a mandate from people to speak on their behalf. This mandate from people give me a very different inroads into the decision-making process, which is non-threatening, non-aggressive.
So it looks like you are a risk taker. And also, you like to make sure that you let everybody hear the voices of the people themselves.
Yeah. And I think I was very lucky.
Yeah.
If I went into the network business in its golden age, then nobody would listen to a foreign student who just got in. Who is Joanna? Who does she think she is? You know, how dare would she come and tell us what to do? And that would be the response. But when I went into the network business, network was in turmoil. Network was being challenged. Network needs to know what the future was, or at that time they needed to know. So they were less protective, less defensive, and they were more open and minded. And a researcher like me got the unthinkable opportunity to ascend in a network business.
I mean, that was rare and a special, opportunity too, because you're definitely not Caucasian.
Not Caucasian.
And you're Asian and a female there. And you climbed up to this position at a very young age, at 36.
37. Every time they say 36, I say, oh, sorry, it was not exactly correct.
Okay.
But I was obviously non-Caucasian. The first time I went to the corporate board meeting, of course, bringing my huge books of data, and I was there just as a supporting staff. I came back and told my boss, you know, I do not see any future for me in this company. I don't see anyone like me. I saw all gray-haired Caucasian men sitting there making decisions. I don't see any opportunity for me in this company. And my boss said, historically, we've made a lot of mistakes. And because of those historical mistakes, you have an unprecedented opportunity in this company. You can break through this glass ceiling and you can ascend. Mm. And I thought that was a really good advice.
Yeah. Isn't there that's a very obvious difference in terms of the culture. Mm-hmm. You can see here, you know, the Western culture, the way they see you as a female, but there's no threat to them, you know.
No threat.
But here in Taiwan, I think there's just all this hierarchy, this bureaucracy here. So how do you adjust? How do you, you know, adapt?
I'll go back to your older question.
Yeah.
My father raised me as a son.
Is that why?
He raised me as the number one child. Not number one son, number one daughter, but number one child. Uh-huh. So I was the eldest of the family, and my father gave me a lot of freedom to explore. Even when I was growing up, most girls were very protected by their families. My father allowed me to travel by myself when I graduated from junior high school and high school.
Okay.
I think that showed a lot of respect and a lot of gut from a father's point of view.
You were never scared?
I was never scared. I was always impatient to explore the world.
Ah.
I couldn't wait to get out.
Mm-hmm.
So he sort of acquiesced to me.
Oh.
He tried to impose a lot of restrictions on me earlier on, but later on he said, okay, I'm going to trust my daughter. But this trust is earned as well.
Okay.
Every time when I made a mistake, I came back to my house. My father always asked me one question. He would say, Joanna, did you make any mistake? Is this your fault? And he made me think whether I should take responsibility of whatever happened to me.
Okay. Yeah. But he didn't rebuke you. I mean, he didn't ask that question to make you feel bad or look bad.
I think he had this tremendous trust and belief in his child.
Mm-hmm.
So he believed that he's raised his children right.
Mm.
And the children should have the ability to figure out things by themselves. So he gave me a little bit leeway to make mistakes. But don't be mistaken, my house rules were really strict.
Yeah.
Up until I was in the last year in high school, during school nights, I had to be home by 7 o'clock.
7 o'clock, that's very, very early.
That's very early. It's only the last year in high school when we had to go to the, under the disguise that we had to go to the library to study, I could stay out until 12.
Oh.
But that was because I was supposed to be studying in the library.
Yeah. Okay. So I know that you actually went to two prestigious schools in Taiwan. It's like the dream of every girl or something. Every child and parents is that you went to the most prestigious, you know, Taipei First Girls High School and also the National Taiwan University.
Right.
Now, that's a dream of everybody. What do you think your experience was? And do you recommend that to the parents these days? Because they care more than the child, you know, themselves about going to these really pressurized schools, wouldn't you say? There's just so much pressure. Going to these schools.
But pressure makes you grow.
Okay, so you're one of those who think it's great.
Pressure makes you grow.
Yeah.
I think people often ask, you know, how do we get to be more internationally competitive?
Mm.
Competition makes you competitive.
Mm-hmm.
You have to go through competition. The pressure and the competition itself is a part of the growth process. If we look at your life, when you were born at age 0, there are no pressure. And there are no expectations. If you eat or drink or even do something crazy, parents are simply happy because you do it. When you are in, say, ABC, when I first went into ABC, when I was 29 years old, the company, the corporation, the society asks you to be able to withhold this much pressure.
Mm-hmm.
So from zero to this much is this long learning process. If you don't learn during your school years, where are you going to have the endurance, the perseverance, the ability to withstand challenges? All these wonderful things that make you a strong person, where are you going to have this?
Mm-hmm.
You know, if you look at my education process, I went to a public elementary school, Zhongshan Guoxiao, nearby.
Uh-huh.
I went into a public junior high school, Bei'an Guozhong, again nearby.
Okay.
Then I went into public high school, public university.
Yeah.
So don't for any minute think that you need to go to a special education in order to ascend. You can go through a regular education process in Taiwan and still have the world as your stage. When I went to Philadelphia for University of Pennsylvania, or to New York for ABC, or back to Singapore for Barron Communications Equity Asia, all of these wonderful things were based on those solid education I received in Taiwan. And those were public education. I didn't go to any tutor. I didn't go to any private tutorial schools, none at all.
Mm.
But the school itself, every single one of them, gave me huge opportunity to break through. This is the point. The schools in Taiwan always had huge restrictions. They wanted students to be in conformity, even in your growth process and your learning process. It almost didn't care much of your cognitive differences. But in every stage of my learning, I was always the outliner. I was always very different. I listened to my own drum. So I'm what they call the different drummer.
Uh-huh.
I listened to my own drum beat and I did crazy things. That's why I said, I can't wait to break through. You know, I always try to escape from what the restrictions are.
Right.
But you can be a child like that and still have the world as your stage. And just like you can be a child like that and ascend, go into the best possible schools through competition and proving that you can also compete.
Mm-hmm.
And I think when you talked about Taipei First Girls High or National Taiwan Universities, those were my only redemptions. If I didn't really at some point saying to myself, come back and you have to be able to compete, come back to study whatever, if I didn't do that, I would be seen as an outcast in many ways. But mm-hmm. because I always came back to compete it and got into what people recognized, I got more freedom,
mm-hmm.
I got more opportunities, and in fact, I got more people endorsing my dreams.
But the thing is, you know, spending all that time studying and working so hard and not having fun.
I didn't study. I had a lot of fun.
Oh, well, say, you're okay, I'm just talking to someone who's just unusual, probably. Unique, you know, an exception, because I think
my grades were horrible in the first and second year in high school, first, second, and third year in college. My grades were horrible because I was doing all sorts of other things.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. In high school, actually, a lot of my fellow schoolmates may remember, in high school, every summer, every winter, I was always out there in the mountains, in the seashore, in somewhere in Taiwan. During school years, I was singing, dancing, teaching people how to dance, doing all sorts of crazy things I never studied.
Oh, well, this I didn't know about you. Well, that's good to know.
Well,
okay.
You can choose. You can have both worlds. You can walk and chew gum at the same time.
Except that you know how this cram school, you know, culture is in Taiwan.
And I never went to any cram school.
Oh, see?
And see, that's the important part.
Yeah, we should be telling the parents, right?
Right.
Don't send your kids to cram school.
You don't need to occupy every single moment of your child's life.
I know.
If you do
that,
you deprive that person of their own exploration of the world.
Mm. Okay, so, well, it's one thing about you, your personality being very outgoing and willing to take on different things and
crazy,
learning and
challenging.
Everything. And on the other hand, you've got supportive parents who doesn't tell you to like study and no fun.
My parents
fun.
Didn't know my grades were horrible.
To this day?
My father probably didn't even know my grades were horrible.
Yeah.
You know, I didn't give him my report cards.
Yeah. How did you manage to do that?
Oh, I took it from the envelope. I took it from our mailbox and signed the name myself.
Seriously?
Wow.
We're revealing all kinds of secrets about Joanna today. So.
Right.
Oh. Well, so do you think that you're closer to your father?
I'm very close to my father.
Yeah, than your mother?
I'm extremely close to my father. I gradually learned to be close to my mother.
Okay.
Because there was a very strong bond between my father and myself. He's, even his jobs, every time I went to a different school, he got a different assignment. He was a military personnel, so he was always assigned to different posts. Every time I went to a different school, he got a different assignment, which was exactly nearby to my school.
Mm, I see. Wow. So I know that you are a very aggressive person and that actually you didn't study law, you didn't know anything about law, but you actually was in a lawsuit. In fact, your father was involved. How did you do that? You
I
know,
think
and it went on for several years. I mean,
11 years, exactly 11 years.
yeah, that's right. It was just resolved recently.
It's the Lafayette case.
Yeah.
I was assigned to Taiwan in July 1st, 2000. On September 23rd, my father was incarcerated, and he was then held without any incommunicado. He was held without any communication with the outside world. And we launched a 83-day action to help him regain his freedom. That's the end of 2000. After that, there were 11 years of endless court trials as well as the other procedures. I started being a very experienced businesswoman. I worked in major merger acquisitions, large investments. I understand legal
Oh, okay, so
issues
you do know
as a
some.
business law person, but
Okay.
certainly criminal law is a
Yeah.
brand new experience, and being charged for something that's so unfair for people like my father is an unthinkable blow in his entire life.
Sure,
He even
sure.
said he considered committing suicide in the first 3 days during his incarceration. So that was an extremely dark moment through which we saw one after unthinkable miracles, so that he was able to be released, and he was finally completely exonerated, both by the court and by the Navy, and then by the control yuan.
Okay.
And the entire process took exactly 11
11 years.
years, from September 24th, 2000 to September 23rd this year.
Wow. Okay. Well, let's take a little break and we'll be right back. Welcome back to People. I'm Shirley Lin. Today, my guest is Joanna Lei, managing partner of Azul Management and also a former legislator here in Taiwan. Well, since you've spent all those years in TV in America at ABC, let's talk about TV. And also, you've also stayed in Singapore. So, how do you see the difference between American TV and Singapore TV and Taiwan?
Certainly, structurally, you will have a predominantly market-supported, free market media structure in the United States. So when I was in ABC, people often, especially from the academic, they would often argue that these are huge animals looking only at money-making and therefore will be ignoring the
Well,
public
isn't it all the same
interest.
with all TV stations, though?
So that's the
Worldwide?
traditional sort of challenges to the United States TV industry. But I can honestly attest to the fact that because you have a large advertiser base,
Right.
you must be, at least in the corporate culture, you must strive to walk a middle road in order not to offend any of your customer base.
Okay.
So in that sense, without any legislative requirements, you are internally self-guarding whether you are walking on the right way, right path. In addition to that, the United States does require broadcast TV to have a division called broadcast standards. You have to be able to tell the outside world that everything you televised is proper, it's not misleading, it's not false. So you have a broadcast standard division that look into all the things except news. News is, First Amendment rights, is freedom of speech, is
Yeah.
freedom of media.
Okay.
Nobody touches that. It's very sacred.
Do we have that in Taiwan, this kind of standard and regulation?
I think Taiwan actually should impose that.
Should. Okay.
Okay, right now, in the States, while you can argue that it's commercial TV, it does have very senior media personnel, very senior news personnel as news directors. They would be the standard holder. They would be the self-sanctioned. They would be the one who says, maybe we go too far here. And we always defer to those professionals to make those judgments on the spot. But in addition to that, because you have a public license and you are making profit using the public license, you have responsibility to the public in terms of their right to know. They cannot be false, misled, or being told untruth. So those are things that you need to be very careful. In Taiwan, while we do have somewhat of a stronger regulatory environment, I think they are now looking at a very small sort of corrective measures. If you televise X, I fine you. You televise Y, I fine you. Instead, if they started asking those entities to have an internal organization, a self-guarding or self-regulatory agency within the company, they can make timely decisions much more so than an outside body, outside regulatory body.
Well, we do have such a body, right? A National Communication Commission.
That's an outside regulatory body. That to me is an outside regulatory body. In the United States, both FTC and FCC have deferred that decision making to the entity that's operating a media itself. So within ABC, CBS, NBC, we all have broadcast standard divisions. The broadcast standard division is like your self-guarding entity. They look into all your relationships with your advertisers, with your producers, sometimes with the outside advocacy groups. If you do a good job within the company, they can actually grab, hold, and even stop disasters from making.
Okay.
They can make timely decision on the spot. For example, one year we have a character who is supposed to be a Vietnamese refugee in the United States and then became the school principal.
Oh.
To me, it is good that you have a Vietnamese refugee, a female Vietnamese refugee. To me, it's good that you have a school principal who is a Vietnamese female refugee. But the character itself was too caricature. His speech was full of accent. His demeanor was very exaggerated. Mm-hmm. And that is somewhat uncomfortable.
Right.
I was at the position to tell the producer, this character, hey, you know, this character may be problematic. How do you do that? You go and talk to the Asian community, the Vietnamese community, and ask them to view this tape and give you their response. And using that response, I was able to ask the producers to tweak the character so that her demeanor, her speeches were consistent with the character itself.
Mm.
So those are the kind of decisions only when you are within the organization and within the process, the decision-making process, you can make. If you are outside, you can only make a decision post hoc.
Mm.
You have to wait until it's already televised and people start launching complaint, but the decision is already made and you have to take a very long time to revert that decision.
So what do you think about Taiwan's TV programs, the quality and everything, and or maybe what we can learn from American TV and Singapore TV even?
Well, because we are commercially supported, even though we have a lot of really great scholars, I do respect them. Because we're commercially supported, a lot of time the decision were made based on economic reasons.
Okay.
For example, we have so many 24-hour news channels.
Yeah.
Therefore, everyone uses SNG to do timely news. But we all know newsworthiness is more than timeliness. You know, you have to make a decision on whether this piece of news is worthy of public interest. And that's the reason for being for any news organization.
Mm.
In Taiwan right now, you know, if you have a disaster, for example, a car accident, if your competitors send an SNG and report it live, you have the tremendous pressure to also send an SNG to report it live.
Mm.
So if from morning to night, I see a lot of timely news being repeated, but very few relevance being discussed.
Mm.
Very few discussions, very few real insightful analysis. And in a large media environment in the United States, every hour of news program, when I was there in 1980s or early 1990s, every hour of news program, we spend out of pocket, that is net of personnel and other costs, we spend $400,000 out of pocket.
Why would you do that?
Because you need to have really great editorial work. You need to
okay.
have every piece of news, if it's worthy, then you would have second report, third report, fourth report behind it to give it more depth.
Mm-hmm.
And if you take a very close look at Taiwan, most of the time on the hourly basis, we're reporting the same piece of news.
That
we
is true.
Have a lot of repetition, but we don't have the second news, the second and the third and the fourth stories in our language. You know, you have to go deeper. You have to go expand beyond what you see as the phenomena.
Mm-hmm.
For example, a few days ago, a 71-year-old man made a major protest in front of the presidential palace, right?
Yeah.
So we have some people reporting why he was there. There was no second story, third story,
fourth
story.
You're saying the one who set himself on fire?
Right.
Okay.
So that's a very good example. If you decided to report that news,
yeah.
It is not just the act itself. Behind this act, there were so many threats.
Right.
And for a self-respecting news organization, you would go and try to trace those threats and try to make sure that you are making the right analysis, even the right criticism, so that the society can move towards a self-reforming direction.
Mm-hmm.
And that's the purpose of media.
Mm-hmm.
I see tremendous pressure, and therefore I don't fault those first-line people. You know, their bosses will say, you know, look at XYZ station, they have this car accident, therefore you must have it.
Mm.
But year after year, day after day, we're only looking at repeated individual, sometimes disasters, sometimes individual set stories, but we don't have any force to move the society to the positive direction.
Mm. I understand you're actually still wearing quite many hats right now. You're still in TV here in Taiwan?
Actually,
no.
Very well. I'm a board director.
Okay.
Because I've always been a media management person.
Okay.
So I still am a board director in a couple of different companies.
Mm.
I wear that hat to just help them move in the right corporate direction. But most of the time, the corporate direction has a very long distance from what you actually see on air.
Hmm. Because I'm thinking about the things that you just shared. If you could. Even like, you know, open a class, a course to teach all these media people
yeah, I do forum
the proper
all the time.
Way to
well,
do
but
news.
Then they'll come to you and say, yes, I understand the proper way. But, you know, my boss look at my ratings and then therefore I need
to
deliver.
Oh, the bosses need to take classes too.
Exactly right.
How do you think about Taiwan's TV covering international news?
Taiwan TV doesn't cover international news.
Yeah, this is really unfortunate. What do you think
Less
the problem
than 1%.
Is?
Well, this is, I'll share with you a story from my friends from the Netherlands. He said to me, Joanna, you know, in Netherlands, we are also a small trading nation, which Taiwan was. Taiwan started being a trading nation. Then we started doing high-tech OEM because we needed to upgrade our own position in the worldwide trading
mm-hmm.
floor. Now, he said, in the Netherlands, everybody reads about 6 newspapers in the morning.
Okay.
We are a very small nation. We need to know what happens around us. So they will need 6 newspapers just to cover the world around them.
Mm-hmm.
Now, Taiwan deals with the entire world. We are proud to be a trading group of people. We go to Europe, we go to Africa, we go to South America, the United States, we go anywhere. But most of the people don't read any international news.
Mm.
Not at all. Not in the newspaper. Now I see one newspaper have probably one full page on international news. Some very small group of people read English newspaper in Taiwan.
Mm-hmm.
Very small group of people even watch CNN or NHK.
Mm-hmm.
Most of the people watch strictly domestic news.
Oh. Well, that problem is one of the reason is that it's not an English-speaking country, Taiwan. And so I think, you know, what ways we can encourage Taiwanese people to polish up on the English, you know, to speak English, to learn the language.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, look at you. You're like, English is like your mother tongue. So mm-hmm. what's your advice to Taiwanese people?
Just don't
about
be scared.
The, yeah.
I think we study too hard. We study grammar too hard. We recite all the words. Languages do not exist in the level of words. You can recite the entire Japanese dictionary. You still don't know Japanese.
Yeah.
So you just needed to just do it. I think that's a very simple word, but very cliche. I hate to use cliche, but on the other hand, you know, even if you don't know English, you still need to know the world. Mm-hmm. The world is what defines your existence. So I would just beg any of your audience who is watching this program, and hopefully you are a decision-making person in the media, to start just bringing the world back to Taiwan. You know, when I was growing up, 1960s, 1970s, 1980s, you could say Taiwan could be a lot more isolated from the world. We still have mm-hmm. a hostile situation across the Taiwan Straits. But when I was growing up, there were huge, at least compared to today, huge amount of international news. You know what's happening in the world,
okay.
even though you don't know English. And sometimes right. Time, Newsweek, and those magazines got torn pages. Mm-hmm. If they reported Taiwan and someone didn't like it, the pages were torn. But still, you receive those information and you right. suck it up like a sponge. Mm. You know, you try to figure out what the world is about. And then when you actually step out to the world, you are not a stranger. Mm. Today, I'm concerned about a lot of the young people. They are very deep into their own interested areas. If you like sports, you're very, very deep into sports. But when you step out of your comfort zone, when you try to start talking to the rest of the world, you are a stranger because you don't know who they are, what mm. they do. You don't know what they think. You know, ask yourself, do I really know what happened to Thailand and Philippines? Mm-hmm. Two nations around us which are currently experiencing turmoil. Do I understand what happened to India and Sri Lanka recently? Pakistan, you know, those are nearby places. Do you know even one leader's name? Most mm-hmm. people say no.
Yeah. Well, we would agree that actually it hasn't been easy for Taiwan. Being a small island, we have so many TV stations and so many broadcasting stations, which is amazing. So there are things that Taiwan is, you know, great, but I'm sure that, you know, there are things too that Taiwan can really improve on. What do you think about Taiwan wanting so much to, you know, globalize itself, to be noticed by the rest of the world? What things do you think Taiwan can still do? I mean, I think it's doing a lot. And as you know, for the last maybe a couple of years, we've done a lot trying to promote our soft power, you know, making ourselves seen and known. What else do you think Taiwan can do? Any advice, any recommendation?
You know, I think we're in a totally different new era. This is a Web 3.0 era. Any individual, not even a country or a company, any individual can have huge influence to the rest of the world. You can put yourself on a new, boundless, countryless world and expose your inner thoughts and share that with a lot of people. You can expose your action. You can put whatever you believe in. So long as we started thinking ourselves as someone, not in a small, isolated island, we needed to have a very different self-image. We needed to take control of our lives. And we needed to say, we can be on the center stage, whatever we're experimenting here, our lifestyle, way of belief, all the things can be shared with the rest of the world. And don't even for a moment think that you don't matter. We can matter, and we can step on the center stage without even have to go outside of your world.
Yeah.
I think even in your program, you don't have to go outside of your world. You don't have to go outside of your studio. With this amazing technology, we all have the ability to affect lives. So long as you set your heart straight and you set your course in the right direction, follow the true north.
All right. Well, thank you so much. It's been such a joy talking to you.
Thank you,
Learned
Shirley.
So much from you. Yeah. So wish you luck in everything that you do. Continue to shine in Taiwan, actually.
Continue to believe that I'm not just a small person.
Okay.
I think that's important. When I was a little girl living right next to your studio,
yeah.
You know, my life is a life of a low-level naval officer's daughter. My life could be very restricted. Mm-hmm. The professor, Ray Birdwistle, who is really very, very close to my heart,
yes.
He's a great scholar, said, there is something called talent mobility. I believe if you have a talent, you can be mobile in the world. In the internet world, you can be extremely mobile. So don't forget, there is something called talent mobility, and don't forget, in the Web 3.0 world, you can move around and share with the world what you believe in.
All right. Well, thank you, Joanna.
Thank you, Shirley.
Okay. Thank you for watching, people. I'm Shirley Lin.